Not here to make trouble. Do you know why I am here? I'm here to grovel before your wonderful Earth Alliance in the hopes of attaching ourselves to your destiny. Like, what are those fish called on your planet that attach themselves to sharks?
Remoras.
Yes. You make very good sharks, Mr. Garibaldi. We were pretty good sharks ourselves once, but somehow, along the way, we forgot how to bite. There was a time when this whole quadrant belonged to us. What are we now? 12 worlds and 1,000 monuments to past glories. Living off memories, stories. Selling trinkets. My God, man. We've become a tourist attraction. See the great Centauri Republic. Open 9 to 5. Earth time. Anything else?
No. Thank you, Ambassador.
Nice shark. Pretty shark.
You have transmissions holding.
Patch incoming signal. Full audio and video decode.
Purple files accessed.
What you are about to see has never been shown to anyone outside the break house.
Hello, everyone out there in podcast land. Welcome to Gray 17, a Babylon 5 podcast. We are a group of newbies and first ones who have either watched the show all the way through or are watching for the first time. And we are here with a very special bonus episode. We are delighted to welcome the man, the myth, the legend that is Peter Jurasik, who is obviously plays Londo Malari in Babylon 5. We are so very thankful that you would take the time to join us, sir, and we are looking forward to chatting with you, and it's a privilege.
Well, Scott, what can I say? I'm so happy to do it for you. So, and I love meeting all the fans, and that's one of the wonderful. It's all a long time back there, so you'll have to forget a bad memory. Or, and as I always say now, there are a lot of people who do Londo better than me. You know, fans can do it better than me. So I don't know what I can do. I'll try to hang in there with you. Okay.
We promise we won't do any bad impressions. At least I promise.
Oh, please do bad impressions, my good and dear friends.
You already showed us up right there with us. That
yeah,
that's right.
So what we're going to do first is, and for those of you listening at home or watching at home, we obviously know that a lot of you have not watched past where we are in the show, which is a little bit through season 2. So the first piece is going to be a non-spoiler conversation with our newbies. And then like any other show that we do, we're going to jettison them out the airlock as soon as they're done with their questions. And then we're going to get into a full discussion of the entire show with Peter as well. So I'm going to toss it over to Emily, who has the first question.
Good. Hi, Peter. I'm Emily.
Hello, Emily.
I just want to say thank you so much for doing this. This is really exciting. So I'm going to do my best to not fangirl and be totally weird.
Please be a fangirl and be totally weird. And the pressure's off me, okay?
I'll see what I can do.
Okay.
My question is, how much of yourself is in Londo as a character?
Well, I'll be honest with you. You know, my wife, who's the person who knows me best, probably, we've been married, I shouldn't say, I don't know, 32 years or something like that. She knows me a long time. Anyway, she says, you know, it was typecasting, that I really am like Londo. Now, for me, I think he's much more energetic. And when I played him, I always felt like, I couldn't wait to stop doing Londo when I was on set. I mean, because he's a pretty aggressive and pretty intense person. And I don't think I'm that intense. But my wife says it's typecasting. And, the truth of the matter is, once you get a feel for what an actor does, as opposed to what the writer brings to the character, then you have a better idea of what it's like to lug him along. And I don't think he walks like me. He certainly doesn't talk like me, right? I got a New York accent, so, and he doesn't have a New York accent. I don't wear his hair, although my hair is getting long these days. But so I don't know, I guess we'll go with my wife, say it's typecasting and I'm exactly like him, but I don't think that, I think he's a much more aggressive, much more, he's certainly made more, much more political and patriotic than I am. I'm much more, I don't know, so that's my answer. How's that?
That works for me. Thank you so much. I'm going to turn it over to Nicole.
Hi, Peter. I'm Nicole. Nice to meet you.
How are you?
Good. Thank you so much for doing this. Really appreciate it. So I'm a newbie and I'm new to not only Babylon 5, but sci-fi as a genre in general. I've never watched a sci-fi show before. Wow. So this is all new to me. It's very exciting and so appreciative that you're here. And I also am going to try not to fangirl and be weird. So you're going to get that a lot from us.
That makes two of us, right?
I love that. So my question for you is, when you were portraying Londo and something really, really funny happened, whether it was a line or a scene or somebody did something funny, because there's a lot of funny moments with Londo, yeah, especially with Garibaldi. So my question to you is, has there ever been a moment that just cracked you up and had you in stitches, or kind of like on SNL when they break, and they break character?
We did that all the time. To be honest, that happens a lot. But, for the most part, really what you're trying to do is focus on the character and mm-hmm. stay in the scene. So, I mean, if people screw up or if we get lost, in the scene, don't know, where the next line is going or what we're doing. Yeah, mm-hmm. We'll let me see. I'm trying to move you around. Okay. No, I can't do it anyway. We would crack up and that would happen. And there was plenty of that. But for the most part, you don't comment on your character. You don't really. So Londo never thought anything he was saying, unless he thought it was funny. He never thought it was funny. The famous nibbled to death by cats, that is, or whatever the line is.
Yeah,
he didn't find that funny, neither did Veer,
Yeah.
But, there was something funny about it, and we certainly knew that.
I think I'll stick my head in the station's fusion reactor. It would be quicker, and I suspect after a while I might even come to enjoy it.
Ambassador, why don't
but
you
this,
just...
this is like being nibbled to death by, what are those earth creatures called? Feathers, long bill, webbed feet. Go quack.
Cats.
Like being nibbled to death by cats.
Joe was a good enough writer too, Nicole, that if you had any question about how you were doing it and whether you were doing it right, he would let you know that. I guess mm-hmm. the exception to that, I don't know what season, you might tell me, the elevator scene?
Not there yet.
Okay, I won't mention it then. Okay. Well, Nicole, there's a scene, and we kind of did it not what Joe wanted, but he liked it. Okay.
Okay, I'll have Scott make sure he tells me about that scene when it comes up.
Yeah, I don't know what season it was in. But, okay, whenever we, Joe was not afraid to say to us, that's not what I was intending.
Mm-hmm.
And he was also, you could appeal all you want to Joe to change something or want something, but he would never do it.
Gotcha. I love it. Well, thank you so much. I appreciate that. And
nice to talk to you.
You too.
I'm new to sci-fi too. You know, Babylon is really the only
introduction
I've ever seen.
Well, it's pretty good so far. I have to say I'm liking it.
I don't know about that, sir. I grew up watching you on the grid, but I know we have a question about that too.
Whoops, you're right.
So I'm going to introduce Justin to ask the next question.
Hi, Justin.
Hey, Peter. Thank you for joining us. And unlike Nicole, I've been a big sci-fi fan for years, but it took about 15, 20 years for a couple of these guys to finally talk me into watching Babylon 5. And I'm really glad that I'm finally doing it, and I'm loving the experience so far.
Wow.
And not only do I have been really enjoying your character so far and watching you on the show, but I especially love enjoying watching Veer. And I've been a big fan of Stephen Furst for a long time, since even back in his Animal House days. And I was just wondering if you can share a story about what it was like working with him on set.
Boy, you know, he's one of the people, we've lost a lot of people. But I basically, I spent a lot of time working with Veer and working with Jakar, right? And so I miss both those people a lot. And both of them became, outside of work, became friends. So my family got to know his family. He got to know my family. We would all play cards together. I mean, he was a friend too. So when I talk about him, I'm sentimental. That's the other thing I always say about Londo. He's a sentimental Republican. I don't know who named him that. Listen, Stephen was a wonderful guy. He and I were like two schoolgirls together. We would giggle and make each other laugh all the time. And that's true. We just liked each other because we shared a sense of humor. He was a very funny guy in real life, very clever and fast. His company's name was Curmudgeon Films. So he liked to think of himself as sort of a curmudgeon, but he was a very funny curmudgeon. And I know that when we were on set together, we both were really fond of each other. We'd spend a lot of time when we weren't in character laughing together. So it was a real joy to be with him. I think we drove the crew and maybe the directors crazy. You know, it was a little like, you know, straighten up there, would you? But we really had a great time together. That wasn't what it was like working with Andreas. He wasn't a jokester as much, but Stephen was really a great guy to hang with. He was really funny, and we had a lot in common as two people. So it was just a joy. He was a really funny guy. The story I always tell that made me laugh the most, and I'm not giving anything away, Scott, I don't think, is they were shooting over my shoulder on Tavir, and his line was, he kind of hated doing the lines exactly, and they wanted us to do the lines exactly. And there's a person on a TV set called a script supervisor, and she's the person on our set, she was a female, who tells you what to do. So his line was, oh, this is what that's about. And he started doing, oh, that's what this is about. And then she'd say, no, this is what that's about. And we'd stop. And then he'd say, oh, so that's what that's about. And she'd say, no, this is what that's about. Slowly, my shoulder that they were shooting over started shaking because it was so Veer-like. You know? He just kept on going. So this is what that. So this is what this is about. And she'd say, no, this is what that's about. Anyway, that's a funny story about Steve, but you know, he was just a wonderful guy. You know the story about his casting, right? Did you ever hear that story?
No. Some of them have, some of them haven't. So please,
he went into to audition for the part, and he knew nothing about the show. And when he got in to audition for it, all the other actors who were auditioning for Veer had their hair up like Centauri. And so immediately he was nervous about that. And all of them were sort of mimicking my accent. They had decided that that's what the character was going to sound like, the actors did anyway. So he started to panic. And he ran into the bathroom and started to, the men's room, started to get soap out of the thing to put his hair up. And then he started to get soap started to come down into his eyes. And then he was kind of crying, right? and moaning. And then that's when they called him in and said, bring in Stephen first. And he went in and his hair was sort of flopping down and he was crying. And he said, I don't know what I'm doing. I wasn't ready for this. I didn't know I had a talking accent and I didn't know my hair was supposed to be up. And when he left the room, JMS said, that's Veer. We're going to cast
him. That guy was perfect. That's awesome.
That's isn't that great?
Right choice.
Yeah. He was a natural, too. That's the other thing to say about him. He was a natural. He's a naturally good actor. And as you know, maybe you do, he was also a director. And so he had a bigger sense than just the two of us as actors. He was always looking out for the bigger picture, too. I can't say enough good things about him. He was my friend, you know? What can I say? Being honest.
Well, that's awesome. I really appreciate you sharing that with me. Thank you. But I'm going to go ahead and at this point turn it over to Andrew.
Hey, this is fun. How am I doing, Scott?
You haven't run away screaming yet, so we're doing great.
Okay, good. If you go away, I will just sit here and keep on talking.
I think the listeners would appreciate that more.
That's the kind of person I am.
Yeah, I think the listeners would appreciate that more, so you'll be fine.
Thank you.
All right, hi, Peter.
Hello.
So I am also a newbie, and one of my favorite things on the show is Londo's relationship with Jakar, which I'm sure many of the fans would agree with me on that. So my question is, what was your off-screen relationship like with Andreas Katsoulis?
Oh boy! Again, you know, you ask a question that it would be really impossible, and it's hard for me to disguise how much I liked those people, and they've also, you know, both died and passed on. So, and I miss them both as friends. They were good friends to me, but Andreas and I were these are some good, you know, some telling things. I think when we auditioned for the show, this was what, months before we did the pilot, he and I were with the same agency and we were both sent in together. And so the very first time I attempted to do Londo and the very first time he attempted to do Jakar, we were together. And I always find that interesting. You know, I had an audition at like 2:15 and the name at 2:20 was Andreas Katsoulis. So we got to sit outside and talk a little bit about the work. He was well before he got into Babylon 5, he was already a very accomplished actor, very successful actor, had worked with Peter Brook in England and traveled around the whole world doing great theater. And you've probably seen him as the one-armed man in what's the name of the movie?
The Fugitive. I just watched that on TV today, actually.
Is that right?
Yeah.
It's sort of a chilling performance, his performance. It's great.
Wait, that guy was Jakar?
Jakar,
Are you kidding? The makeup,
right? Yeah.
Right?
I had no idea. I've seen that movie 100 times. I had no idea. Wow, you just blew my mind.
Performance, isn't it, Nicole?
Wow,
it's kind of a scary performance.
You just blew my mind.
Anyway, he was very, very accomplished actor already, and so when I started to work with him, I had a great deal of respect for who he was, and I think he was just a respectful guy. He was that kind of person, but he had a great deal of respect for me. So we took our work seriously, on screen, we were very serious and we really got down to work when we worked together. Off screen, he loved us, you know, and he would stay sort of in character because he was fully covered, as you know, his face. And so he would be puffing away on one of his ubiquitous cigarettes. And there was a part of him that felt like he was still kind of buzzing Jakar. And as I told you, I was looking to get away from Londo. Londo was following me around all the time. So I wasn't doing it with Andreas. And that, you know, he, you know, out of makeup, We became really dear friends. He would cook for me. And again, I got to know his family. I still communicate a little with his family, with his daughter. And he got to know my family. So we were good friends. And he was a funny, really funny, really odd person. He was the definition on the set of a loose cannon. The scene would start and you really didn't know what Andreas would do. He would change things from take to take and just happy to do that. And, you know, it was just fun to work with him. Off screen, he had a little of that personality in life too. He was Greek and crazy and a good guy, a good man. And, you know, again, these are people I love, so I can't really give you a great answer. I can't be a critic at all. I got nothing to say that doesn't kind of, you know, make me, what do they say? Did you say Cavell, right?
I will say, Peter, to that, if it weren't for Londo and Jakar, and I think other people in this who have watched the whole show would agree with me on this, without Londo and Jakar, we are not talking about this show 30 years later.
Oh, I don't know about that, but there you go. That's nice to say. You know what? They were, in some way, again, I don't want to give any spoilers, but that their stories really became central in a lot of ways. So, but there was, you know, I mean, anyway, that's nice of you to say. I'm not the person to comment on that because, you know, to be honest, I had my hands filled just being Londo and taking care of the Centauri end of the storyline. And so you fans can talk more about the Mimbari and the Don Narns, you know, and I can't comment on that. You know, I like the character with the big hair.
Well, great. I'm glad I finally got to meet you.
So nice.
So now I'm going to pass.
And thanks for asking about Jakar, by the way.
Yeah, no problem. Sure we were all wondering about.
Yeah.
So now I'm going to pass you on to probably Gray 17's biggest Londo fan, John.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Dear friend, where is John? Oh, John.
Peter, unlike Emily and Nicole, I am going to fangirl out and I'm going to be weird.
Thank you.
On this episode. I, like Justin, watch a lot of sci-fi, but this is my first go around with Babylon 5. And, you know, like Andrew said, you are thus far my favorite character. Absolutely. One of the first things on our show is if we have an episode that you don't happen to be in, it's my first critique of the show. Well, no, Londo.
That's great, John.
I'm very glad to have you here. And I know you mentioned Andreas working a lot and being a prolific actor before the show, but you know, you're no slouch either, right? So you've got over 80 credits to your own name, been a lot of productions, a lot of roles, some of the most beloved series of all time, not just Babylon 5, but you've been in MASH, Tron, Hill Street Blues. You know, the list goes on. I won't bore you with your own CV, but with so much diversity.
If I can just parenthetically say, you know, this is what $50 gets you. You know, I gave John $50 and he brags for a little bit. You know? The rest of you should pay attention, you know.
He's a cheap date. That's
Thank
for
you,
sure.
John. My good and dear friend. It's good to have friends, isn't it?
If you were looking for a hype man for free, I would probably be on that role. But what I wanted to ask you about, though, is you've got such a diversity in the roles that you've taken throughout your career. And I was curious which one might be your favorite to play, not the specific part, but which type of parts do you enjoy more? Do you lean more dramatic, you know, anything else?
John, pretty early on, I mean, it's really about the writing. It really is. You know, the famous, if it ain't on the page, it ain't on the stage line about acting. That's really true. And if you're if you're a lover of acting the way I am, and I am someone who loves to act, the writer is really the center. So whenever I'd get good writing, those were the things I liked best. So good writing first. And in terms of characterization, Hollywood especially likes to put you in a little box. And so when I first got to Hollywood, it was very easy for them to make me the lawyer, you know, the guy in the suit. I could play that stuff. Then they kind of got a feel, if you ever saw it in my work on sitcoms, like on Barney Miller and stuff, they said, oh, this guy has sort of a maniacal edge to him too. And so they started to play me, but they liked me as sort of a straight guy. And then I got to a place where I was lucky enough that I would start telling them, nah, I don't really want to play the lawyer. Thank you. I'm not going to, or I won't take the doctor part, you know, because that's what they would like me to do. And that was a lucky thing. I mean, when I look back on Hill Street Blues, Stephen Bochco, he had cast me in a show before Hill Street, and he had me as a college professor. Well, that was easy for me to do, you know, and it was with James Earl Jones. So it was really a great scene and I had a great time. But when he started to offer me a couple of lawyers on Hill Street, I said, no, let's wait for somebody more interesting. And eventually, you know, Sid the Snitch came along and, you know, Sid had a lot more interesting lines to say. And, you know, there was a lot more to sink my teeth into, too. And I had a great writer, David Milch, and was really my writer on that show. And he would follow you around and listen to you talk and then feed more of your own who you were into the work. So it was really great. And that's what I started to live for.
Thinking world. And it's not 10 pounds, Norm. That's not the amount. And it's not 20 pounds, Norm. Which 20 pounds, Norm, gets broads and limousines and a house anywhere you could think of. And not 40 pounds. Not even 60 pounds, Norm, which is $750,000. Norm, 80 pounds. 80 pounds, Norm. That kid's intestines were down in his testicles with the weight of that suitcase. Norm, I am going to ask you a question once. And I don't think you would respect me as a man if I didn't. That Bobby, he's a mouse. He is looking to off this stuff for high four figures. 7,500, 10 grand max. 10 grand. And knowing the kind of person you are, I wouldn't be surprised if you don't have that in a bank account somewhere. Am I right? And that Bobby is out of the picture. And you and me, Norm, are struggling like this with that suitcase between us. I know that you are in law enforcement, but I'm asking you as a human being to consider the possibility of an entire fresh concept and start in life. Hmm? Okay, Norm, I'm gonna take my hand away from your lips now. It would mean, Norm, so much to me if you gave me some positive indication that you would consider what I am suggesting. Is there a glimmer, Norm? Is there any possibility?
None.
None in the sense of what?
None.
Meaning?
Meaning none.
None.
It was nice and I was lucky that I could always go back and play when they wanted to cast me as a straight guy, put a little rep tie on, you know, comb my hair back, put my glasses on, and there I could be the doctor for them or the scientist. But it was always more fun for me to play. It's everyone will tell you it's more fun to play a bad guy than a good guy, too. So that's why my wife again reminds me that the very first time I read the script of Babylon 5, I sat outside our house and I came in and said to her, oh, I love this character. I really want to play this character. I'd really like to get it. And she remembers that. I don't remember that. But I love that he was such a baddie and he was so, you know, in the pilot. He was a pretty screwed up guy already. You know, he was in a corner in his life. And I love that.
Maybe that's why I relate to him. I don't know.
You know what? In a real way, John, that's, you know, that's more like who we are as people, all of us, right? The idea of excellent being, I always am proud of the people who can play that. You know, I don't mean this in a bad way, but, you know, Sinclair and Sheridan, those guys, you know, they're, you know, heroes in a lot of ways. That's hard to play. Excellent people, I call them. It's hard to be an excellent person. I'm not an excellent person. You know, you obviously aren't either. I know. But no one is, right? No one is, as we know. So it's much more fun to play bad people, troubled people, people in a corner. So that's what drew me to Londo, certainly.
Well, listen, I very jealously would like to take up the entire rest of this hour and continue chatting with you. But unfortunately, I have to be fair. And so I'll say again, though, thank you so much for coming on. Hopefully,
I'm happy to do it.
I enjoy chatting with you. I cannot wait to see the rest of Babylon 5 and your performance.
It gets better and better. You know, remember the first season for you newbies, the first season, like any show, if you go back to the first season of, I don't know, Seinfeld or any show that you like and go back and look, you'll see that both the writers and the actors are struggling to find their footing and, you know, stepping into holes and making mistakes. So it gets better. I think Babylon gets better. You'll see.
Well, harder to think you get better, but I'll take your word for it. And I, again, appreciate you coming on I'll pause my fangirling and we'll go to Jess.
There is a Centauri inside that guy. I can see you, moon-faced assassin of joy.
You've got no idea.
Oh my gosh.
Definitely taking that clip.
Oh my God.
Definitely using that later.
I got to say, it breaks my brain a little bit whenever you switch from your kind of New York lilt into Londo just seamlessly like that.
Right.
He's floating around in there. What can I tell you?
Oh, Peter, I'm Jessi, and I am so very grateful to be able to have you here and be part of this. This has probably been one of the cooler interviews that we've done. So
thank you, Jessi.
Appreciate you being here. If you did not, let's take acting out of the equation. And if you were not an actor, where do you think you would have seen yourself career-wise? What do you think you would have done?
I spent 4 years in a Catholic. I'm not a Catholic anymore, but I was a Catholic and I spent 4 years studying to be a priest. And I thought I would have liked to have done that. And I found that subject interesting and I found the work sort of interesting. I don't know that I could have pulled that off, you know, at some point, you know, whatever turned me away from it. And I look back, and now I'm 72 years old, right? So I look back at my life a little bit and I think I wish I would have done something that had a little more meaning to it in my life. You know, I had a really rich career. I'm a wealthy guy, you know. I mean, I'm a secure guy. I'm not a wealthy guy. Wealthy is such a funny term now, you know, but I mean, I'm a successful actor and had what a lot of actors wished for. But I still wish I would have been like a doctor and maybe to help more, something a little more altruistic. But when I get to meet people like you, people, all of you, you and everyone, I realize that through my work, I touched people in a good way, made them laugh, made them cry, made them think, whatever, you know, that all comes through JMS. He penned all the thing, but we bring the characters to life and make them walk around and talk. So I don't know. I would have liked to have been maybe a doctor or something like that. But, you know, I have as I said, I'm satisfied at 72. I'll say I'm glad I chose to be an actor. That was good. It worked out okay. And I'm good at it now. You know, I worked hard at it. I went to school for it and you know, became successful. So it seems like it was the right thing. But
I definitely think that there can be a case made that you've had an impact on people's lives. You've just brought great joy to people. I'm one of the newer ones, so I have not seen the whole show, and Scott has dragged me kicking and screaming through the first season, and we're getting
it can be difficult the first season, so it I'm was, glad you got and, through it.
Yes, I questioned my life choices for several episodes. But it's something that I'm beginning to thoroughly enjoy it, and I'm watching the episodes and I'm just loving the characters and loving the development. Your character is amazing and you're an awesome person, and we appreciate you being here.
Right. You know what? Don't forget what I said. And probably, you know, that, I mean, you know, your business inside now, and I know and first seasons are difficult. You know, people are finding their way. And the nice thing about Babylon 5 is that I think it does hit a good stride in the second season, and then really starts to groove a little and we get better. So you'll like that.
I appreciate you so much, sir. Thank you so much for being here.
Nice to talk with you.
Yes.
Go ahead, John.
I'm going to say, speaking of a groove real quick, do you happen to play that guitar behind you there, sir?
Do I have what?
You play that guitar behind you?
Oh, yes.
Ooh, I think we'll have to get him on to play a song for us.
I charge a lot of money.
Give that 50 back.
Yeah. You're losing that 50.
The only thing I do for free, obviously, is Londo impressions, right? Not even that well. I said there are a lot of people who can do better than me still now.
Well, that's the last of our newbie questions, but I think Blake had something else he wanted to bring up before we do kick the newbies out.
Okay, Scott. Yeah. Sounds good.
So, hi, Peter, and thanks again for doing this. And, you know, one of the things Scott and I did when we brought the newbies in is we pretty much issued an embargo of things they could not search on the internet, watch on the internet. We pretty much banned them from Google, YouTube, Facebook groups, Twitter, anything else we could think of.
Well,
as a long
sound
time
like band, a Narn.
Yeah, honestly, Blake is the Narn of the group. Absolutely.
Yes. So one of the things is, you know, I've watched a lot of the fan panels, different things. Particularly there was one in Phoenix that had all of the surviving cast. It was really big. I think it was the 25th anniversary one.
Yes.
And one of the stories there was you and Andreas and a prank you played on JMS at a convention. And I think our newbies would appreciate hearing that one since we banned them from watching that. I think they would like, because you brought up the Veer story from that audition, which comes from that also. So I think they'd love
it. Oh, yeah. Well, the story that Blake is referencing is it was really one of our first conventions too, Blake. It was early on. And we were a little surprised at how enthusiastic people were about the show. And it was a little surprising for us. And Andreas and I had gone on and what we asked the audience to do when we were on stage together was that JMS was going to come on after us, and before he arrived, we let them know that we thought it would be a good idea that when JMS came out, if they would not react at all to anything he said, give him a smattering applause when he came out, and if he said something funny or heavy and dramatic, to not react at all. And that worked out just great. The audience was happy to do it. So JMS comes out and they say, here's J. Michael Straczynski. He's the author. I mean, he's the writer and he's the creator of the show. And here he is. And, you know, tepid applause from the audience. He's already getting, you know, he's not a performer. So the flop sweat started pretty early. And Andreas and I were in the front row, you know, watching him die. And he said, hello, I'm J. Michael Straczynski, and I'm the writer of Babylon 5. Nothing. This perfectly quiet. He started to sweat more and it got worse and worse. And they basically just hung him out to dry for the longest amount of time. And it was such a pleasure to see him think that no one cared who he was, what he had to say, that he had done Babylon 5. It was a little like Babylon, what? You know, he got us back by writing an episode where Andreas and I, and he really pushed this. He had Andreas, he made the Narns able to, I guess in a defensive way, be able to change gender. And so he had Andreas changing into a woman, a female Narn. And he actually, we got the script and everybody got the script. And it was, we were all worried, like, what the hell is it? Because the script just came to us. And you know, Mira called me up and said, oh my God, Peter, it's terrible. It's terrible what Joe is doing, you know. And he made Andreas go into costume and they fitted him for two large breasts. And we were to end up in bed together. And he had a bedroom scene for us where actually we were both at the end of it smoking.
Oh my God.
The afterglow scene.
Oh, and no.
He got all of us back pretty well because he played that to the hilt. And he had costumers and makeup people and the producers make Andreas. And I think we were really going through with that. And that's where it was. Character. Anyway, thank you, Blake. That's you kind of had to been there to see Joe die, but it was fun if you were present. It was great to see him swing.
That's fantastic.
I'm now envisioning the scene, and I think Natoff is sitting by the door waiting for it to be done.
Yep. Yeah. Oh, my gosh.
Yep.
I actually have that script, too.
So.
Oh, God.
Smooth operators playing in the background.
Was there pink underwear in that one?
He wrote it beautifully. He really wrote it beautifully.
Oh, my. I have an idea. I'm going to chat with you later, Peter. I have an idea.
Oh, no.
Oh, no. No.
Again, what did I say to John? It's going to cost you a lot of money.
I think it'd be worth it. I think it would
money
be.
Well spent.
I don't know that I could. I don't even know if I should. Joe would kill me. Bro. I don't know. He may be out there somewhere. I don't
he
know.
He hasn't banned me from Twitter yet, it. So we're fun.
He put it out. You know, everybody got a copy of it. He played it really perfectly. No one. He made us think it was happening. So.
Only they would have filmed it. If only they would have filmed it.
Only they would have filmed it, right? Yeah. Quite a funny scene. Anyway, so great to meet you people. And what a gratifying thing for you call yourself newbies, but you know that you're starting the show. That's really gratifying for me. So I said, it's a long time back in my past, but it's nice to know that people are still enjoying the show and enjoying the work. Thank you.
Well, they love it.
Thank you.
I mean, honestly, I mean, you guys, I mean, all of you guys who are part of the show are making new fans every day. So thank you for what you guys did that 30 odd years later, new people can experience it and love it as much as they did back in 1994.
Well, you know, that's also a compliment to you people as viewers, too, that you look past, you can put it in the proper perspective of 30 years back and whatever that means in terms of what special effects or whatever it was. But that's great. Thank you.
To put that in perspective too, with the new viewers, I've been watching a lot of Babylon 5 for a long time, but now my kids are watching it with me because I'm watching it for this show. And my 12-year-old loves to crochet, so she finished this guy a few days ago.
Now you wait right there. Hang on a minute.
Oh, okay. Here we go. It's show and tell time. It's show and tell time.
For those listening to the audio podcast, I have a Londo crochet.
Can you guys see me?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
This holiday, I got this.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
Pretty close, right? I love he's got a little purple shirt underneath it. Can you see it all right?
Wonderful. Yeah. So cute.
Yeah. Wonderful.
Is that something? And this is the only thing I got off the set.
No kidding.
Yeah. Now, in some of my quarters, in the background, you can see there were, I think there were three of these.
Mm-hmm.
And Warner Brothers was just terrible. They said they asked me to beg in triplicate, you know, could I have something just to remember when the series was closing? And they made me write it in, you know, duplicate and triplicate to different people, and then rejected me, said, no, you can't pay. They were going to sell everything. So I pocketed it.
As you should have.
I deserve that, right?
Awesome.
There you go.
Well, we were interviewing Marshall Teague, and I won't say what we were interviewing him for because the folks haven't seen that character yet, but he walked out with the sword that he had.
Wow.
So.
Some people just were, you know, I mean, Jerry Doyle, God help us, you know, Jerry was a great guy, but he had a major pair of balls. He'd try anything six times, you know, he really would. He's a very funny guy and a great guy. And I think he got off with, you know, a small U-Haul pulled up to the set.
Oh, jeez. That doesn't shock me.
Loaded things out.
You know, Peter, my other favorite dynamic on the show was Londo and Garibaldi. So it's really funny that you said that because I was debating between asking you the question I asked you and about him, because I just absolutely love the dynamic between you guys. And I feel like that was very genuine, probably the same off screen, too. So thank you for sharing that about him.
He was a very funny guy again. And you know, very much what you saw is what you got. With him, he was not, as you know, not a really experienced actor, but he did the smartest thing. What he took was just brought himself to the work. And so what you saw was in a lot of ways who he was, too. He was funny, smart, a wise guy, you know, bright, very bright. Anyway, yeah, he was a great guy. Again, we became friends. I'm sad to talk about it, but he's gone.
Yeah.
He was a great guy, a good guy.
I would find it hard for anyone to not want to be friends with you, to be honest, because you seem pretty cool.
You're sweet. Well, thank you for saying that.
On that sugar note, we're going to go ahead.
I'm flattered easily, but I accept it. Thank you.
You're welcome.
On that sugarly little note that Nicole left, we're going to go ahead and kick the newbies out now so we can talk spoilers. So before we go, if you guys can, you know, say your goodbyes to Peter, and then we will.
Lots of love, you guys. Thank you for being so nice. Really
thank you.
Nice.
Bye, Peter. Thank you so much.
Fantastic. Enjoy the rest of the show.
I mean, honestly, Peter, thank you. Thank you for everything. It means a lot to us.
Mm-hmm. To us, to me too. Thank you, you guys.
Awesome.
Each one of you. Thanks.
All right. Take care.
You.
Bye.
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 Thank you for listening to Gray 17, a Babylon 5 podcast. You can find all the places to listen to this podcast and links to our social media accounts at anchor.fm/gray17podcast. We want to hear from you, so please join the discussion on Facebook and Twitter. Be sure to subscribe and leave a review. Gray 17 is a part of the Front Row Network and NPR Illinois Community Voices. You can find all the Front Row shows at thefrontrownetwork.com. Gray 17 is not affiliated with, and this podcast has not been prepared, approved, or licensed by Warner Brothers or any other owners of the Babylon 5 copyright. All audio clips included in this podcast are the intellectual property of their respective copyright holders. They are included here for the purpose of review, and no infringement is intended. The opening and closing Babylon 5 themes are available from Falling Matter on YouTube.
And what's out there?
The rim.
And beyond that?
The truth.
We've now kicked out the newbies, so if you haven't seen past season 2, this is where you should exit as well. And after that, we're going to go ahead and just talk about the entire run of the show. The first question I have for you, Peter, just to throw it out there right away. The Londo arc from the beginning to the end is obviously, for many of us, one of the biggest arcs of the show. He goes through so much trials and tribulations, and literally ends and finds redemption at the hands of Jakar around his throat.
Yep.
How do you feel about that arc, and how'd you feel about going through that trial for 5 years?
You know, Scott, really, again, I forget who asked it in the first section there, but, you know, as an actor, you live for something like that television series, you know. In a television series, it's easy for them, the writers and the producers, if they can put you in a little box, your character, and say, he's what, the evil sister, or the evil brother, or he's the bad doctor, or, you know, because it's easier to write an ongoing serial if the characters are not moving forward, backward, out of focus, in focus, who the stories. And because Joe, as he said, saw this in the whole thing in one big kind of arc, to get a character that was moving. I mean, when Londo starts, as I said also in the beginning, he was a guy who was stuck in a corner. He was in a lot of trouble. He's drinking a lot, gambling a lot, very unhappy, very disappointed where his, you know, he was a super patriot, as you know. In later seasons, you get a sense of how vulnerable he is about his people and his patriotism. It's in a lot of ways his Achilles heel. But for to have him like that at the beginning, and then for Joe to take him, have him rise up to such power, and then turn it so wonderfully and keep turning the character, it was a treat as an actor, and it was fun to do. It made it so much more interesting. I mean, we would get the scripts, and we were as excited as the fans when they watched it for the first time were to see where the show was going. You know, we'd get a new episode and say, wow, this is fun. This is interesting. I didn't think it was going here. You know, all I can say is that the arc was, it made it a great character for me. It made it really fun. It was enjoyable to do. And I thank, I said in the first part, you know, I'm happy to get any work as an actor, you know, because I know it's a tough business and all that. So I'm happy to play whatever they're paying me to do this week. But it's wonderful when you get good writing and a character that has nuance and grows and change. And that was really fun for me. That was wonderful. It wasn't a burden. As I said, Londa was to be him on the set was a little tiring occasionally. And I wanted to get away from him a little bit because he's pretty intense guy, as I said. Mm-hmm. he's not a chill guy. There's no chill. He's not a Mimbari. And, what's Bill's character's name? Lanier, you know, he doesn't got a lot of Lanier in him. So I needed to get away from him, but I love that Joe changed him and had him grow and change.
And you mentioned that writing and that intensity. I think that's one of the things we've commented on a little bit is even in the scenes we've seen, and there's some great ones coming up, particularly in season two, where both yourself and Andreas have probably some of the most intense performances and scenes and dialogue. There's this one scene where I know you're in the council chamber and you just scream, you know, you want something done now. And just that's the power on that scene. And you even mentioned the elevator scene that we cut you off on because we're not there yet. But that was another just incredible scene, but the intensity of it and what both of you put into those roles.
There's no one there. It would appear that we are on our own. I don't know how long I have been unconscious.
2 standard hours.
2 hours? And you have done nothing? I would point out to you that this door is extremely hot. There is a very good chance there is a fire out there. And even if the fire doesn't get in here, the smoke and the heat will eventually make it impossible to breathe. And we will die. In here. With enough effort, we can probably force our way through the ceiling. Perhaps I have not made myself sufficiently clear. There is no telling when help will come. Unless we get ourselves out of here on our own, we'll probably die here. So we must work together.
No.
No. What do you mean, no?
No.
Well, you want to live as much as I, hmm?
Oh, yes, but I would much rather see you dead.
Well, let's see. Well, here I am. Come on, kill me. Come on, kill me.
Oh, you forget the terms of our surrender. The penalty for the killing of any Centauri by any Narn will be the death of 500 Narns, including the perpetrator's own family! But I don't have to kill you. I don't have to do anything. And I still get to watch you die. I find this most appealing.
This is insane. We must work together.
No. As the humans say, up yours, die.
Believe it. How? You are mad, do you know that? We're in here. Can anyone hear us?
I hear you.
In here.
You know, Blake, as I told you, Andreas and I auditioned together and we were friends and knew each other and kind of went into it. And one of the things we talked about with Joe early on was that he was less interested in being, he was kind of afraid when we did the pilot that he was going to be the bad guy for the whole thing. And I was going to be a buffoon or I don't know what, you know, I even thought about him at first. So we loved the idea that Joe made them go like this and kind of pass each other. And my character became in set 2 and 3 darker and his more enlightened and lighter, right? So it was great. You know, we both loved that. And we stuck together as two actors, as two friends. We even negotiated our contracts together. And I mean that seriously. So, I mean, we traded off our place in the credits at the beginning and things like that. So we stuck together because we understood, both of us understood, this is, you know, you might be able to find a higher paying job at that time, but it certainly was good writing and fun to do for us both.
I don't have anything necessarily spoilery, but I wanted to ask you a little bit, you know, your pedigree, see, you got your start in theater, stage acting, and And I even saw somewhere in your note, feel free to correct me if my research is faulty, but you even dabbled in doing comedic performances at times.
That's where I started.
Yeah. Okay. I feel like you can certainly see that, like, if you don't mind me saying, in your character, you're very naturally funny. You're very naturally funny, and you're that part of your personality comes out in Londo really, really well. At what point did you kind of transition away from doing live performances into the kind of television behind the screen onset stuff?
The truth of the matter is, you know, as you said, first of all, I studied my major was theater. And so then I went to New York and I worked in theater there, and I was too dumb to appreciate that I was getting cast and making a good amount of money, and thought, you know, why are they not taking me more serious when I was getting cast in more comedic stuff? I went away and worked in repertory. So I got my fill of playing dramatic stuff. And when I got to Los Angeles, it was a matter of how I was going to showcase myself. How are they going to see you out there? And at that time, one of the ways that you could showcase that was easiest was being at the Comedy Store. And, you know, both at Sunset and Westwood, where the two comedy stores were. And I could have ended up in a serious acting class. I could have chose that, but instead I chose an improv class and ran into people like Michael Keaton, Betty Thomas, who was eventually on Hill Street Blues, the people I did The Village Idiots with, Mark Ganzel, who's turned into quite a good writer and producer, God rest his soul now, a woman named Jan Fisher, who wrote Lost Boys, the movie. And we were all doing comedy together, and then got to perform two or three times a week in front of producers, actors, you know, at the Comedy Store. And the first pilot I did was the Jimmy Walker show. The other people in the cast, regular cast, were David Letterman, Jay Leno. I forget who else, but, you know, David Letterman and Jay Leno were with the same management as we were. And so that was a way into getting a showcase in Los Angeles comedy. It was a better showcase than doing serious theater. For me, it was great, you know. It opened me up to I started doing sitcoms, you know, and stuff like that. And that was great. And then other people just saw, well, he has a nice edge. And you know, as I said, good writers start to listen to you and get a sense of who you are. And you know, they'll play into some more nuance, more serious nuance. It's a great question. And you need a tremendous amount of luck. You know, you got to be good, I guess, when it comes along. But, you know, well, you got to be ready for luck, like everybody says. But it takes a lot of luck, you know. I was lucky that I went to an improv class and Michael Keaton was in it and became a friend of mine for my life. You know, that was pretty good break. And he was comedic, completely comedic at that time, and got his first break. I forget, it was a night shift, I guess, was the movie, something. But Betty Thomas and people like that, they were all doing comedy. So that was a good and just a lucky move by me, because I could have ended up I took myself so seriously that I could have ended up in a, you know, real serious acting class. And God knows, you know, I don't know.
And I want to, if I can, I'll segue into another kind of question I noticed as I was browsing through the catalog. You actually crossed paths with Bruce Boxleitner, I think, at least three times throughout your career, from Tron, Scarecrow, and Mrs. King, and then, of course, B5. Was that a coincidence, or was that kind of a knowing the same people? And
By the time we did Scarecrow and Mrs. King together, we were already buddies and friends. He was a contemporary of me. I think he was, he's my age. He was born in 1950, like I was, a couple of days, it's May 5th or something like that. So we're the same age, so we naturally knew each other. We didn't go up for the same part, so we didn't audition together. People who I auditioned were the more character actors, like, people like Armin Shimerman from Star Trek. He was a guy I would see all the time, and I became a friend of his because I ran into him all the time. Basically, I would spend auditions, that I would audition 3 and 4 times, sometimes a day, for commercials. And I was a busy actor, and people, I was in demand, which he was also in demand. And so I got to know him. And Bruce was the same way. Bruce and I knew each other, from just around town. The joke of, it's not a big town is true. It's real. It's not a big town. The people who work in that town are the same kind of people, especially the character actors. We were all, we all knew each other from auditions, from around. And so Bruce is a very different person than me in terms of what he does. He's a leading man. He was the perfect guy to be our captain and to be number one on the call sheet, as they say. He's an elegant guy that way, and a good guy. He doesn't flash his good looks or his power. He's really modest in that way. He's a perfect kind of quote leader. So he was great. And yeah, we did become friends. The coincidental thing in that one show, Scarecrow and Mrs. King, the girl who ended up playing my wife on that was actually the girl I was living with in Hollywood at that time. And that rarely happens too.
Anyway. To that point, because we've asked this question a couple times on our show, when did you all find out that Bruce was joining the cast? Do you remember?
We of course never knew anything about how unwell. I'm blanking on his name now.
Michael O'Hare.
I'm sorry,
Michael O'Hare.
I'm sorry that no one ever told us that he was how ill he was, and it became obvious as the first season went on that he wasn't going to be able to hang together anymore because it was getting more difficult for him. And he was just not well. So at one point, I think we were all aware that he might be replaced. But we are, whether Babylon 5 was going to go on was a big deal every season anyway. We were not a favorite of Warner Brothers. We were not, although we had some good reviews and stuff, a lot of people didn't like our show. So we were worried about whether the show would continue. Not only would Michael O'Hare, would we get a second season? So we didn't really find out that Bruce was involved. I don't remember, to tell you the truth. I can't honestly say whether it was like, bam, the start of the second season, and there he was. But as I said, we all had a sense that Michael was starting to tip, and that he wasn't going to be able to do it. It's just he was too unwell, and it's too hard to be that person. He was, again, like I mentioned in the first part, he was playing an excellent being, as I always call them, excellent people. It's really hard to play good guys. It really is hard. You gotta steady as she goes and all that, steady hand. So, and he was not doing well. I never knew that. So I don't know when I knew when Bruce was coming on. I can't answer that question. I don't remember,
Sure. Peter, I'm Kevin. Thank you so much for being on with us. One of the things about Londo is that he was very different at different times in the show. He could be sentimental. He could be fiery. He could be someone who, you know, was sword fighting with an old friend. Is there a particular time in the show that was a favorite of yours because of that, those differences?
As I said, you know, I would say it was, by episode, I would love when Joe would surprise me so that I'd get the next episode and think, see, I didn't think he was going to go there with the character. You know, certainly I loved the major twist, you know, all the stuff with Mr. Morden and the darker turn in his character, the darker turn with the third and fourth season with Shakar. And that was great to play. But I liked when he would throw me, as you referenced, funnier stuff. Or there was a part of Londo that was, because he was such a patriot and intense in some ways, that he had blinders on, and so he could be a real dolt and say funny stuff occasionally. He would say stuff, it's not right on the money, but the stuff about cats and that famed Nibbles to Death by Cat. That's a great, that was fun for me. I love that he would have him do that he would, from an audience point of view, you know, he looks like a bit of an idiot when he says that, and I love that, the whole episode with the insect in his quarters, right? Mm-hmm. And before he develops language skills and whatever. Those lines were great to do. Those were fun stuff for me to do.
Centauri, you triple damned. Do you know that you are smaller than I thought you were? You are smaller. There are more of you. There are more of you!
He had to turn me, he pulled me away from Garibaldi, because as a writer, what he did was he wanted to move me into more, take the character, not me. He wanted to move the character more towards center in the script. And so he got somebody like Veer to fill up some of the comedic stuff more on the edge. And by dropping Veer in, Veer would take the real funnier stuff, and that pushed me more towards center. That allowed me. And I was sorry to give that up, because I liked it. I enjoyed when Londo was buffoonish and, when he wasn't smart, or the technomage episode, you know? That was fun for me. I love that episode. Oh, I don't know what that episode is called, but that was a good time.
We actually just hit on it a few weeks ago. I loved when you're sitting at the computer and it tells you you've just bought 500 shares of Butterflies Incorporated. Your reaction is just amazing.
See, and I loved that. That was great. And even that he had to go and eat crow with the technomage at in the final scene was fabulous to do. That was so enjoyable for me to play. You know, when will this torture end? Remember? He says that. How long will this spell keep on going on? I've waved it already now. No problem. But, you know, that endeared you to him, you know. The romantic part of him that he dropped in, too, was fun for me to play, too. I wasn't particularly comfortable with that because I never played that in my career. But it was fun to do. And it was nice to have that aspect to him, too. Great question. Thank you.
I was going to say to that scene, too, with the Technomage is it's funny as hell. But then it goes so dark with I hear the voices of billions, and you say, my followers? No, you're right? Victims.
Yeah.
And it's like, just how it can turn on a dime. It's just, that's JMS in a nutshell. And also you as an actor being able to pull that off. Is now in
final check prior to departure. Excuse me. I wanted to thank you for your amusing little gift.
It took me 2 hours to repair the damage to my quarters, and I don't think the smell will go away for days. Now, if I may ask, does this torment end when you leave? Or am I going to have to spend the rest of my life paying for one little mistake?
Oh, I'm afraid you're going to have to spend the rest of your life paying for your mistakes. Not this one, of course. It's trivial. I have withdrawn the spell, but there will be others.
What are you talking about?
You are touched by darkness, Ambassador. I see it as a blemish that will grow with time. I could warn you, of course, but you would not listen. I could kill you, but someone would take your place. So I do the only thing I can. I go. Oh, I believe it was an endorsement you wanted. A word or two, a picture to send to the folks back home, confirming that you have a destiny before you.
Yes, it was just a thought, nothing more.
Well, take this for what little it will profit you. As I look at you, Ambassador Mallory, I see a great hand reaching out of the stars. The hand is your hand. And I hear sounds, the sounds of billions of people calling your name.
My followers?
Your victims.
Well, JMS wrote it for me, though. You're right. And that is nice that he's smart enough to do that, too. He would, in a sense, set the audience up. And you guys were enjoying seeing Londo eat crow a little bit and, you know, see him come crawling back and then turn the scene, as you said. That's the great thing at the end and just leave him there. You know, yeah, your victims. Right. It's going to get black.
Mm-hmm. Michael and Sarah was really good in that scene too.
Wasn't he?
Yeah. I grew up watching Tron. I think I probably wore out our VHS tape, but the other one I wore out was the Buck Rogers, and he was in the pilot of Buck Rogers as well. So
he was a little like, how I described Andreas, that he was, in the best sense, so wonderfully serious about his work when he got there. And I love that about him. You know, he wasn't young by the time he did that. And I don't think it was even easy for him to be an actor. At some point, it gets difficult when you can't remember stuff and you lose some focus. It's harder to be a good actor. And, But he was so serious about the work. It was great. He was a great guy to be on set with. Fun. Really not fond memories of him.
Are there any other notable guest stars that you have particularly fond memories of throughout the run?
Well, I love Rifa. He was terrific. I love Robert Krimmer playing Centaur. Yeah, what the emperor's name? Our young emperor.
Cartesia.
Yeah, it was. You know, he was a fun guy. They were people. Bill Forward. Is that his name? Bill Forward, who played
Rifa. Yes.
The people who jumped in wholeheartedly, the guy who I had the sword fight with, I can't remember his name now.
Carmen or Genziano.
Oh, what a great fun actor he was to work with. I mean, they were unafraid. I had to, I was smart enough or I cared enough about my own welfare and the show's welfare that when a guest star would come in, especially if they had to be a Centauri for the first time, they put them in those wigs. Some people would get a little nervous, you know?
Sure.
And so I tried to coddle them and let them know, hey, it's going to be all right. We're going to be able to do our work and it's going to be serious. And you know, but there are people who jumped in. Bill Forward jumped in. I mean, he did the accent, no less, right? And Bob Krimmer, you know, Cartesia, he just, you know, he was in with both feet. And the guy who played the emperor the emperor before us, who I can't remember his name. Anyway, those are fond memories. The guy who I was most intimidated by was in the first season. And he's the guy that he was in Clockwork Orange. And he played in Clockwork Orange, he played the parole officer. And he is the actor that I lifted the yes, yes, that from. You know, if you go back and look at Clockwork Orange and watch that actor work with Malcolm McDowell, he ended up being a guest star on Babylon 5, and I was completely intimidated by him. He was an English. We had a lot of English actors, as you may or may not know. And, you know, they have such sterling credentials when they show up, and they're trained so well, they can be a little intimidating. And that guy, I was completely, I didn't know what to do. I was afraid he was going to, like, you know, out me and say, you stole that from me, didn't you? Yes, you did, didn't you? Yes, yes. You know, and he was great. I wish I could remember his name. I'm sorry. I'm not good with names, and I'm getting old. So you guys can look it up.
Yeah.
Don't he worry, Kevin. Kevin will. He's my encyclopedia when it comes to actors' names.
The only one I'm finding is Deltoid.
That's him.
Okay, Mr. P.R. Deltoid. Deltoid. It's a
Mr. Deltoid.
Okay.
What's his? What's the actor's name? Do they have?
Yeah, let me get it.
I don't remember what he played. Thank you, Kevin. I don't remember what he played in Babylon, but it was the first season, I'm positive. Because I was completely intimidated by him. He was a terrific and was in a lot of stuff.
Aubrey Morris?
Aubrey Morris, that's it. Yes! He was somebody I was really excited to work with, you know. He really was something.
Well, Peter, we really do appreciate you taking the time out with us. And
this was a treat for me. You can tell I loved it. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, we can. Absolutely. And I'm on a side chat with the newbies, and they are singing your praises right now. So we really do appreciate it.
I'm always loving, you know, when you get pretty women to sing my praises. Thank you.
Noted.
It's good to have friends, is it not?
Yeah. Is there anything you would like to add before we let you go?
You know what? I the only thing I ever want to add is the fact that, you know, we've lost terrific people. And it's so nice to have you guys, what I said about keeping the show alive. I don't know who said it, but they say if you mention people's names after they pass, that it keeps them alive somewhere, you know? And it's so nice that you still, all of you, still like Mira and, you know, you still like Garibaldi and Jerry and Andreas and Steven. That means a lot to me because it keeps them alive for me too. So bless you guys all. That's great.
I steal this line from JMS all the time. May they be in memory still bright.
That's it. Thank you. Well, I had a ball, so you guys can ask me back anytime. And I'll
I was about ready to say, you made it easy for me because I was going to say we would love to have you back, but it's been such a treat. I can tell you personally, I was 9 or 10 when I first saw you. Well, actually, I was younger now on Tron, but when I first saw you in the Londo character, I was hooked, and you have been, I'm sorry to say, a part of my life for 30 years, and I really
that's
okay. do appreciate
That's good.
It. It's been amazing.
I'm so nice that you invited me and I had a ball. So thank you so much. Mutual, you know?
And they always say, don't meet your heroes, but man, you have knocked it out of the park. So thank you so much.
Well, you guys are great. Flatter me. As I said, Londo's, he's a hard act to follow. So there you go. But thank you.
Well, we'll go ahead and end it there. Thank you so much, Peter. And I'm going to take you up on it. And also, I've got some ideas for that script if we can make it work. Got some ideas.
Just send numerical figures. That's all.
Understood. Understood.
And we can talk about it.
If you want to join our Patreon and help out with that, you can find our Patreon link down below.
Now, okay. Thank you all. And thank you
thank
all.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you so much, sir. This has been a real
really
treat for
fun.
Us.
Thank you, guys. I'm off. See ya.
Thank you, sir.
Have a great night. Thanks again.
Yeah. You too.
See you as well.
Thank you.
After tonight, I don't know that I will ever see you again. And I wanted to. Say goodbye. I don't know why that should be important to me now, at a time like this, but it is. In the months and the years to come, you may hear many strange things about me, my behavior. Well, they say the position changes you. And I just... I wanted to...
I understand.
Perhaps. And perhaps you do not understand as much as you think. Pray that you never do, Shakar. Pray that you never truly understand. Well, I must hurry. Our ships will soon be in firing range. Isn't it strange, Shakar? When we first met, I had no power and all the choices I could ever want. And now I have all the power I could ever want and no choices at all. No choice at all.
Molari. Understand that I can never forgive your people for what they did to my world. My people can never forgive your people. But I can forgive.